Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. Now, while normally we do, like I just said, go through the oeuvre of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song, once a month, what we're able to do because of the very kind support from the people over at Patreon, we were able to do a bonus episode over here on the main feed. So a huge thank you to everyone who helps support me over on the Patreon. It allows us to do this, but also some other fun things that happen on the Patreon from time to time. More on that probably in March. Look at the Patreon and they'll update the people who are following me over there. But I thought what would be nice would be to return to James Lapine, who of course collaborated with Sondheim on first, Sunday in the Park with George, and then afterwards, Into the Woods, and would eventually collaborate with him again on Passion, to look at one of his movies that he made. Now, I did have a guest lined up for this who needed to cancel last minute, and then I had a second person say that they could help out who also had to cancel last minute, and so I asked a few other people who it was a little bit late to both watch a movie and then jump on to record with me in time, so it's me solo here this week, just you and I, talking about the movie Life with Mikey.
Your little Mikey.
You remember?
I used to watch you all the time. You were so cute.
I'm still so cute.
Michael Chapman used to be a star.
I'm little Mikey.
So what?
Now, he's just a talent agent looking for a new client.
It's so cute at this age.
How much of this crap do I have to eat today? What am I, Job?
Then he met a performer.
If you didn't steal anything, what is this?
That would turn his life around.
I tried to steal it, which is wrong and bad and terrible. But enough about me.
If you can do it in front of a television camera, what you just did in front of those people, we could be very wealthy. Like you to meet Angie Vega, our newest client.
Well, hello, Dolly.
Who's the troll?
Touchstone Pictures presents Michael J. Fox and Christina Vidal. Ugh.
You said she doesn't go to school. She steals. She ran away from home. Ah!
Coffee.
Coffee?
Yeah, coffee. It comes from beans. Ever heard of it?
We're now representing the...
So a few things I think like need to be Christmas? Said before like I jump into talking change. About the movie itself. First, I think I mentioned this when we talked about the movie Impromptu a few months ago. That was the very first James Lapine film. So he was getting, you know, rave reviews on Broadway. He tries to transition into feature films, makes this movie called Impromptu, which was like fine. I've already forgotten that movie. I think I said in that very episode, I was forgetting about that movie as I was watching the movie. But broadly speaking, it feels like James Lapine has like the best example of movies that don't exist. Now, I've used that phrase before and people have written in and have asked me what I mean. I am stealing this phrase from another podcast called Blank Check. Their whole deal is that they pick a movie director and then go through their entire filmography from first film to last film. And then they move on to a different director and do the exact same thing. The hosts over there, Griffin and David, have this descriptor called Movies That Don't Exist, which is basically an example of, boy, this has like a really recognizable star in it. It's directed by a very recognizable person, and yet I bet you if you asked anyone on the street, even film fans, the vast majority of people would have no idea what you're talking about. It is essentially came and went and left no residue in the popular culture. It just was released. It is a thing that you could probably still watch, but like nobody is talking about it. Nobody has referenced it. Nobody listed it as one of their favorite films. Like it just is a movie that feels like it does not exist. James Lapine has made a history of that, in my opinion, in that if I open up his filmography right now, like I said, we start with Impromptu, released in 1991, and stars Judy Davis. It has Hugh Grant, it has Mandy Patinkin in it, it has Julian Sands in it. There's a bunch of famous people. Emma Thompson is in it. And like outside of this very podcast that you're listening to, who has talked about Impromptu in the last 30 years? So that's followed up with This Life with Mikey that stars Michael J. Fox, has Nathan Lane in it, has Victor Garber in it, has Cyndi Lauper in it. Like, is a film that feels like more people should be referencing or have a fondness for like a Home Alone or one of those like family films from the late 80s, early 90s. Follows that up with this movie called Earthly Possessions in 1999 that has Susan Sarandon in it, Stephen Dorff in it, Margot Martindale is in it, Boyd Gaines is in it. So, again, nobody has seen that film, probably. And then, lastly, in 2016, he did direct a film that starred Viola Davis, Hayden Panettiere, Tony Shalhoub is in it, Ellen Burstyn is in it, Raul Esparza is in this movie, and on Letterboxd, 575 people have logged this film. Like, nobody has watched this movie since it was released in 2016. I just find it hilarious that he is able to grab so much talent in the four films that he has directed, and yet they have left literally no fingerprints whatsoever. Now, I say that, but there is one other thing I think I should mention about this movie specifically, Life with Mikey, in that this is a blockbuster movie shelf movie. For me, being the person who would often just go to Blockbuster and browse the shelves, because I'm old and I used to go to movie rental places, and I used to go and rent movies on the weekend. The amount of times that I have seen this videotape or DVD with this movie poster on the front, conservatively have probably seen it 10,000 times. It was a constant. It seems to be always on the front shelf for some reason. So I'm sure someone has stumbled across this and watched it at the time. But I never felt compelled to be like, yes, today's the day that I'm going to watch Life with Mikey.
Listen to him, Ed. He's great with kids. Look what he did for me.
Ed, I turned her from a pickpocket into a star, into a shoplifter. You think that's easy?
Yeah. Hi, we're here for the open auditions.
I'm sorry, ma'am, but the agency is closed forever.
Listen, my daughter has a wonderful voice.
And I've been practicing and practicing.
Practicing and practicing. Ed, listen to me, all right? I want to tell you something that I've never told you before, all right? When they had the Life with Mikey auditions, and Dad took me down, and they said, we're not seeing any more kids. And Dad said, I'm not leaving until you see my kid. And we stayed there until they saw me.
Mom took you to those auditions.
All right, so do it for Mom.
Yeah! I think in part because I am one of the biggest Back to the Future fans. Like, I adore Michael J. Fox in those trio of films, but especially the first film, charming in Teen Wolf. If you're the same age as me, you maybe have caught him also in Family Ties, in reruns or when it was first airing. So there was this time, specifically in the 80s, where Michael J. Fox was the biggest thing. And then he crested into the 90s and kind of struggled a little bit before he returned back to TV with Spin City. But this is right in that time of him just trying to figure things out. Nothing like really hit for him, seemingly. Like, he just tried to do dramatic works, horror, comedy, just trying to find his voice in cinema at that time, and nothing really ever stuck. I think that there is a cult classic film that comes out just a few years later, which is, well, actually, there's two of them. First is The Frighteners by Guillermo del Toro, who does have its fan base. I probably would count myself among them, although it has been probably 25 years since I've seen that film. And the other one is Mars Attacks by Tim Burton, which I'm kind of an apologist for. I know many people hate that movie, but I'm a champion of it. I think it actually is good. It's one of the last handful of good Tim Burton films, in my opinion. Regardless, he tries and tried, and I think that there was, for me, just as an outside observer and being a young person at this time, this air of desperation at this time. I think I wanted to continue to see Michael J. Fox in a whatever role he chose to not be an adult yet. I was just so beholden, and this is not the right way to look at it, but I was a kid. I wanted to retain him in that teenager, maybe early 20s role, and was not ready to see him in like an adult, like I'm a dad role sort of thing. Especially because the poster kind of pitches this movie as something that it's not, because there's this trio of kids on the poster. So if you don't actually pick it up and read the back and see what this movie is about, it feels like this movie is about him and these three kids trying to get along with each other. And that's really not what this movie is about at all. If you were like me and have seen the poster of Life with Mikey and have never actually read what the movie is about, or this is your first time ever hearing the words Life with Mikey read aloud to you, let me go to IMDb here very quickly and I'll read out the plot description for you. So the quick description here is, a once popular actor who now runs a talent agency specializing in child acts is trying to discover the next star. He gets more than he bargained for when he recruits a child pickpocket. So that is basically the setup to this movie. Now, to kind of straight up spoil my feelings about this movie, it is like, this movie should be, just on paper and looking at the people involved in it and the subject matter of it, this movie should be way better than what it ultimately is. Now, that is not saying it's bad. This is a perfectly watchable, pleasant family film from the early 90s. So there's a couple of things that have not aged the greatest in it, but overall, like, it is just what you would come to expect if you were going to go and watch a light comedy starring Michael J. Fox in 1993. What that also means, however, is that it's a little bit better than Impromptu in that I'm probably going to remember certain elements of this movie. Like, it's not just completely mind evaporated, but there was no strong hooks in this either for me. And I think, I was struggling a little bit to try and figure out why that was. Why was it that this movie just was not clicking for me? Because Michael J. Fox is doing so much heavy lifting in this movie to make it work as much as it does. He's doing some strong work here. The pickpocket that they reference there, this young girl, also does a pretty good job. I think she gets past the kind of normal thing that happened, again, in this time period of just like the really annoying kid who just knows more than every adult does. I think she's still able to retain her feeling like a child, still being a bit streetwise, but still being not like an annoying know-it-all character. And their interplay is good. I think they have good chemistry with one another. So I was struggling with it. Why is this just not working for me? Elements, there's good setup. It just never feels like it comes together. Why is that? As I normally do when I watch movies from basically like late 70s to mid 90s, I go and search for the Siskel and Ebert clip. So that's what I did. And both of them were pretty muted on this movie as well, but they were able to sum it up exactly why it is. And the reason I think that this movie fundamentally doesn't work is that there's no actual conflict in it.
Life with Mikey has some endearing moments, and I enjoyed all of the performance by Christina Vidal, a no-nonsense kid who is smart and can act and doesn't make the mistake of milking her role for pathos. But the movie doesn't tell much of a story. It seems to meander from one event to another, and it doesn't really have a third act at all. I sat there liking the young actress and wondering why Michael J. Fox seemed to be without a clue in a lot of his big scenes, and then I figured out it was because the screenplay never really develops any tension or interest for his character. There are the ingredients here for a fun comedy, but there is no payoff.
You're quite right, Roger, and that's because if you think about the Michael J. Fox character, the big problem for him is, will his little agency business go under, okay, mm-hmm. with this little twerp kid leaving it, you know, possibly. And yet, if it succeeds, he's going to be unhappy because he hates being an agent for these kids. So he's in a lose-lose position as far as our rooting interest mm-hmm. is concerned, so that doesn't work at all.
You know, that could have been fixed so easily with two lines of dialogue in which he loves the agency. Mm-hmm. This agency has become his life, and he loves working with kids, but he's a bad businessman. Okay. And then it would have created all the tension you needed.
All right, here's another approach. They could have said, let's make it sharp-edged rather than warm and fuzzy and cuddly and show, you know, the real stage mothering and the real conniving. In other words, not do it as sort of a little storybook, sweetheart, little fantasy. Either approach would have been better.
As cliche as it is, it's not like he doesn't want the girl and she wants him, and so then we finally discover at the end that they both live happily ever after. Or it's not like he's desperate to make his agency work, and like this is his one last shot at greatness. Like, it flirts with those ideas, but like in the text of the movie, he hates his job, he doesn't want to do it anymore, but he doesn't know how to do anything else, so he feels like he's compelled to do it. Then he finds this girl and there's great big success, but outside of her struggling with one commercial she does, she kind of just knocks that out of the park and then is good for the rest of the movie. There's this family drama that they try to bring into it, but again, that's resolved really quickly as well. So everything, it just gets resolved. There's no like rising tension. There's no like villain that they're really fighting against, right? There's not like, whatever, the big city mayor who's going to like come, or like, there's not like the big wig CEO who's going to come in and take over the agency, or a rival kid that they fight through the entire movie. There are elements of those that pop in, but there's not one that goes through the entire runtime. And so I think it's a little bit frustrating. I think, again, just going back to the Siskel and Ebert thing, I think them rightly saying is like, the way that the character is written, if he succeeds, we don't want that to happen. And if he loses, we don't want that to happen. So we're in this like no-win situation. The supporting cast is a who's who of great actors, a lot of them from Broadway. Mandy Patinkin shows up for like 5 seconds in this movie, which is funny. But Nathan Lane does some great work in here playing, forgive the pun, the straight man. He's like kind of the co-owner of this agency. And again, he brings a lot of pathos to his role, but we kind of just want him to succeed as well. It's like he keeps getting roped back into this company that by all rights should fail. Like they're not really good at their jobs and they're definitely not seen actually talented kids. Cyndi Lauper is the receptionist and she's really fun because Cyndi Lauper is able to give her like ditzy New York City persona to good use as someone who's answering the phones. Victor Garber shows up as like this grumpy dad of one of the other kids, but like again is only in one scene for 5 minutes, so there's wasted potential there. All in all, it just is a film that I did not hate while watching. Like if I was to give a rating to this, which I did on Letterboxd, I gave it a 3 out of 5. I waffled a bit about whether this was like a 5 out of 10 film or a 6 out of 10 film. Ultimately, I gave it the 3 out of 5, the 6 out of 10, which is like moderately passable, enjoyable. There's nothing like aggressively awful with this movie. The frustrating part is that there's not anything that's great in it either, but you have all this talent and it feels like there should be this exploration of childhood of childhood star status. That's the one element, the kind of the meta element of this, is that the character Michael J. Fox is playing was this famous child actor on a sitcom, on a really popular sitcom, which he would have experience with. And I think he does bring some of that experience into talking about his past within the context of this character in this film. I don't know. I mean, it's not that comedy shouldn't be used for this type of thing, but the more I watched it, I was like, what you're setting up here is far more like sad and pathetic and dramatic than what a comedy allows you to be. And I feel like, again, if this was slightly rewritten and pitched slightly differently, or at least the tone put into it was slightly different, this would be, I think it would play a lot better, where it is a man really coming to grips with his own mortality, because A, he literally can see himself as a young person being adored by millions, now being an adult who is irrelevant, and trying to figure out, well, what value do I have now in society, and how can I usher in the next childhood talent in a way that doesn't corrupt them like it has me? And can I shepherd them, or can I point them in the right direction so that they find a future that I didn't find myself? And I think that is the hook to this movie, that it actually promises you, but it never actually delivers on. And in fact, the ending feels like very pat and we just need to wrap this thing up and we're going to sing happy birthday and everything is all right now. Even though I was like, I actually don't think everything is all right here, I'm sorry to say. Shout out to David Krumholtz, though, who was like the master of playing the smarmy kid back in this time period, would go on to be in The Santa Claus as the elf. Bernard was in a bunch of films in the 90s and early 2000s, was recently in Oppenheimer, if you've seen that movie. So he's making the rounds, all the current award shows. It's a bummer, man. It's a bummer that this film doesn't like knock this concept out of the park. Some of the comedy lands, I think some of those beats, some of those character moments are so well done, and actually really well captured by Lapine, who I have to say never strikes me as much of a visual film director. He's competent. Like, it's not like the camera is out of place or out of focus or isn't able to capture a scene and use the emotion within it effectively. He likes to use long takes, which was also kind of a standard for most film directors back in this time frame, but it allows the actors to really emote properly without having to chop it up here too much. All the elements I think were there. I just think it comes back to script problems. I think that's actually where the majority of this problem lies, where people within the creative team saw the potential of this, but didn't like really buckle down and be like, okay, but why are we doing it this way? What if we tweak these certain scenes here, or the tone in this scene here and make it build up to something much more rewarding. Just looking up here too, Mark Lawrence is the writer who would go on to write anything that I know. Oof, woof. The screenplay for the remake of The Out-of-Towners in 1999 did write Miss Congeniality, which, you know, has its fans, 2 Weeks Notice, Music and Lyrics, which has a lot of fans, I know. And the last movie he wrote was Noelle, the one that stars Bill Hader and Anna Kendrick. So that is the history with that writer. Can I also just say, what also bugs me a lot is that Nathan Lane isn't like a huge movie star. And maybe he doesn't want to be or ever wanted to be. I think he wanted to be at one point, but he's had such a phenomenal career on the stage. So this is not to belittle his talents. I think he is one of our great actors and has proven that over the last few decades. But outside of The Birdcage, and of course his voice work on The Lion King, I don't know if any movie has ever really figured out how to use his talents effectively. Like even here, even though he is doing a good performance, it's not bad, but it's like, I know what Nathan Lane can do, and you're not really giving him much to shine with here. I'm just really hoping for a director to come along and be like, hey, Nathan Lane's movie career has been kind of a joke. He's also joked about it himself. Like, there's a punchline of Nathan Lane kind of spiraling out of Hollywood. But I feel there should be a director that comes along and is like, I can use him effectively. There seems to be a lot of auteur directors out there that are wanting to use him. I mean, he was in the last Ari Aster movie. Oh, he's in another one that's coming up, but he was also in Dix the Musical here recently as well. So he's like dipping his toe back into kind of these supporting performances, which I love to see. You're actually seeing his acting chops on display, but I want him in that like lead role of just a meaty performance so he can show to people like, hey, this guy can act. And I think movie fans don't realize that he can. All right, anyways, because it's just me talking, these bonus episodes tend to not go very long because I have no pitter-patter I can go back and forth with people with. It's a movie that exists, Life with Mikey. It's kind of a downer because I wish it was better than it was. But if you have fond memories of Life with Mikey, please let me know. And to play us out here this week, because they do reference this song, we'll do Everything's Coming Up Roses, because one of the children auditions with it in a supposedly hilarious fashion. All right, talk soon.